You've been called the Da Vinci of our time. What do you say to that?
Absolutely ridiculous. I don't paint.
Welcome, Gothamites, to another episode of the Arkham Sessions. My name is Brian Ward. With me, as always, is the psychologist to the superheroes, superheroines, and supervillains of Gotham City. And now, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Dr. Drea Letamendi. Hello, Drea.
Hi, Brian. That was weird.
It is
not weird,
right?
So much as just we've just expanded to our reach.
Yeah, we're jumping ship, going to the competition.
I don't know that I'd say jumping ship. I'd say adding to the fleet.
That's right. That's right. Well, right now we're starting this episode with phase one of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, dating back to 2008, which just seems crazy to me. When you look at the list of movies that have come out since then, it doesn't seem all that crazy. But when you think about the fact that just a few years ago, little over 10 years ago, is what, 2008, 19, 20, 20, 13 years ago, people were complaining that Robert Downey Jr. was going to be Tony Stark.
Complaining meaning they did not want him to be Tony Stark?
Yeah, when the initial news came out, it was mixed. There were a lot of people that were happy about it. And then I remember distinctly being in conversations with people who were very unhappy about it because they just didn't think he'd be able to pull it off. Up to that point, Robert Downey Jr. had been known for a handful of roles in sort of the Brat Pack era. He had an amazing turn as Charlie Chaplin, for which I believe he was nominated. And then after that, it was mostly just his off-screen troubles with drug and alcohol use. And no one thought he'd be able to pull off a role like Iron Man. Not that Iron Man, people have to remember at the time that Marvel decided to do this phase one, they were choosing from like C-tier level characters. Like no one thought this universe would be as big as it has become in the last 13 years. This really was built from the ground. And in fact, I would say subterranean levels up to the franchise that it is today. Where they literally just opened up the Avengers campus at Disneyland and Disney World in Orlando, honoring this franchise of heroes that no one thought would make money. All of Marvel's most profitable heroes belonged to other film studios at the time. And so this is all they had left. And no one could argue that this group of characters haven't dwarfed the other franchises entirely in that amount of time. So it's super, super impressive. I will say last week we did the Snyder cut of Justice League and had what I thought was a very fantastic reception to it. We had a lot of people comment on it. Some of them agreed with our take, others didn't. All of them basically said that things that you said, or even things that I said, oddly enough, made them think about the movie in a way that they hadn't before. Drea, how do you feel about that reaction to the Snyder Cut last week?
I think that we really did a different coverage of that movie, yeah. Only to mean that I know that other shows and certainly folks who are reviewing the movie from this cinematic analysis, that perspective. I think this conversation that we had was much more about the characters themselves, and mm-hmm. often we are reacting to what we have in the story.
Yeah.
That's about the psychology of the characters. We can't really comment on variants and things like that, but we did take a chance to bring in the context of the film, and in particular, the changes, the transformation that occurred between the first version and the ultimate version of the film that Snyder ended up with. Mm-hmm. I think we contributed to the discourse in a way that people may have appreciated. Yeah. There's like a different take on it.
Yeah.
Nonetheless, anytime I talk about the Snyder cut, I do get some negative feedback in the form of trolling and just mean comments.
Yeah. Social media is not kind with that sort of,
no,
with just choosing a side one way or another, or not even choosing a side, simply mentioning it one way or another, is a bad thing on social media. I'm sorry you have to deal with that.
Thank you.
I want to talk about Marvel though. I always loved Batman, but I grew up a Marvel kid. And so this is a unique thing for me. You grew up, when we look back at the beginning of our podcast, it all started because of something you grew up on. And now we've moved into the universe that I grew up
yeah,
on.
Yeah, it's your turn.
I don't know about that. I don't know all these characters nearly as well as other people. Certainly a number of them I grew up reading. So it is fun to look at them. For starters, let's do like we did back in the day. Let's talk a little bit about Iron Man, Tony Stark. What did you ever know growing up about Tony, pre these movies?
Oh my gosh. I knew about about one characteristic,
okay,
that he was an alcoholic.
Okay.
This is something that came up many times when I was studying comics. So it didn't come up when I was reading comics as a kid, because as you said, I was reading DC Comics, I was reading Archie Comics, I wasn't reading a ton of Marvel. Mm-hmm. But when I got into grad school and started to study comics a little bit more, this is the character who came up pretty frequently when I was exploring PTSD and alcoholism. Mm-hmm. And there is a cover of...
I can almost guarantee I know the one you're thinking of.
Yeah, everyone probably knows what I'm talking about. It's this cover of an Iron Man comic book, and I believe he has a drink in his hand, and he's just like bloodshot eyes, and he's...
He's leaning over the table.
He's like drunk or experiencing some kind of alcohol related fatigue or exhaustion, and he looks pretty bad. And that's what I have associated with Iron Man for quite a long time, that he has this dependence on substances, and that's his flaw. Like, to me, that's how I think about his psychology.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's think back to the beginning of Tony Stark. This was Tales of Suspense, so it was the early 60s. I would say 62, 63, as I look, March 63.
Tales of Suspense was like this was a comic book that had a bunch of different adventures, and he happened to be a character that was introduced?
Just like many of those popular comic book characters, they would start in a magazine that was full of various characters, various stories, and you would sort of throw it out to the public to see what stuck. What's interesting is so few times did you know exactly what stuck from any one comic, because by the time that issue came out, or by the time the numbers came out, other issues had come since then, and you didn't fully understand which character. I mean, Superman was the exact same way. People didn't immediately understand the impact that Action Comics number one had because of Superman, because he was just one of several stories within that book.
Right.
But yeah, in this particular case, it was issue 39 of Tales of Suspense, where there's a person I'm thinking of, Stan Lee.
There's a person I'm thinking of, Stan Lee.
For some strange reason, I could not bring up his name. Stan Lee and Larry Lieber. Like, Larry Lieber was the writer of that story. Uh-huh. Stan basically gave him, because he was the editor and sort of the mastermind behind a lot of the the kernels of these ideas. He basically said, look, I want to develop a character that is a businessman, that is a superhero in his quote unquote spare time, but is really the height of capitalism. And I also want to create a character that is going to be hated by our audience, because when you think about the early 60s, you were dealing with the Cold War. You were dealing with Vietnam, and you were dealing with all of this anti-war sentiment. So they created this character, Stan and Larry Lieber, and then the Iron Man character was designed by Jack Kirby and Don Heck. They created a character who was a war profiteer, for lack of a better term. He manufactured weapons used for war during a time of anti-war sentiment. Mm-hmm. And the challenge was, how do we make you love this character? And interestingly, it worked. And I don't know how you come up with it. You know, it's like slapping your audience in the face and expecting them to love you for it. And they did. And you can actually see why. It's because this guy has demons that he is wrestling with. You are getting an opportunity to see a character realize what they have been doing wrong their entire lives, and then actively doing what they can to turn it around.
So the film really tries to capture this persona, mm-hmm. or I'm calling it a persona, but I truly believe that parts of Iron Man's personality are authentic. I'm looking at it through this Bruce Wayne, you know, Batman
lens.
That's
the danger.
I know. But some of it, I think, is a performance, because he does see himself as different than others and kind of has this detached style to his interpersonal relationships. And on the other hand, there does seem to be this just this candid self-concept that he is superior. And on the one hand, that's not a likable feature. On the other hand, is he, you know, where's the lie? Is he wrong? He's brilliant. He happens to be charming.
Yeah.
And I'm talking about Robert Downey Jr.'s Tony Stark as,
but the original character as well. I mean, the original character was that Bruce Wayne playboy who was a famous, brilliant inventor who was, in fact, injured during a kidnapping. And just like in the movie, his heart was in jeopardy. He could have died had a man by the name of Ho Jensen not helped him. And they carried that over to the film. And you know, you're absolutely right. No, let's talk a little bit about Robert Downey Jr. Because as we mentioned at the top of the show, there were questions as to whether this man could actually even finish the job. You know, this was John Favreau really, and Kevin Feige and anyone else, really taking a leap of faith on a person who had not really been able to do a whole lot with his career after his own personal problems. And yet he turned out to be, just as I predicted then, the perfect Tony Stark.
I can't imagine any other actor as Tony Stark.
It's like the character was created for him.
Right.
I mean, and let's be clear, because in an interview with Jon Favreau, he even said about casting Robert, quote, "The best and worst moments of Robert's life have been in the public eye. He had to find an inner balance to overcome obstacles that went far beyond his career. That's Tony Stark." That is Tony to a T, you know? And he went on to say, "Robert brings a depth that goes far beyond a comic book character having trouble in high school or simply can't get the girl." So yeah, you need someone who can bring their experience of having that troubled lifestyle, both as the son of a famous actor and of a Hollywood family, and someone who has struggled their entire lives with alcoholism and drug use and has ended up in other people's beds when he thought that it was his own, who's ended up on the news with all of this spectacle and scrutiny. There's no one better to play this part.
Is your feeling on this that he knew deeply the emotional places he needed to go to be Tony Stark? Like, what I understand is that in order to play Tony Stark, not only, yes, I think you need a fundamental connection to the lows, a fundamental connection to this sense of loneliness, mm-hmm, and addiction, mm-hmm, and depression.
Yeah.
And hopelessness. My sense, though, is that you also need to know the character really well, because that describes a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And Tony Stark is a very unique character.
Yeah. I mean, you have to, you're right. And you have to also be equally charming and equally witty and equally likable. I mean, you have to be the asshole that your audience is going to fall in love with. And that is Robert Downey Jr. And what's interesting is...
But I'd say there also has to be a little fragility to that.
No,
right? Because otherwise we would just absolutely hate him.
Yes. Yes.
We would be... There would be too much revulsion,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And so he knows how to play that part and have those ingredients, but also do something that's really relatable, mm-hmm, that we don't feel sorry for him. I think it's this sense of, oh, we get it. Mm-hmm. And you have to be pretty good at presenting those angles to us.
Yeah.
In a single movie, you know, it didn't take, I forgot that in the first movie, you see already this transformation.
Yeah. Yeah. And what's interesting, we'll talk a little bit about it more, is Robert Downey Jr.'s Iron Man has such an amazing character arc over the 13 years. He goes from a character who is likable but unlikable in the first Iron Man, and doesn't fully, even by the end of that movie, change. And we'll talk about that. But here's another little tidbit, and I don't know how much you did or didn't know about the making of the film going into your most recent rewatch last night, but you want to know why else Robert Downey Jr. is the perfect person for this?
Why?
How much of that dialogue do you think was scripted?
Oh, his lines?
A significant amount of the dialogue in the movie itself was improvised.
Interesting.
By the time they started shooting the film, because they were so hyper focused, Feige and the Marvel team, on the action sequences and those moments that required a lot of attention, that there wasn't a whole lot of attention spent on the quieter dialogue moments. And Downey would be responsible for creating that Tony Stark character to much degree. Now, obviously, they're going to, it's Marvel. They're not going to spend this much money and risk it being crappy. I'm sure there was a significant amount of polishing as they would go to make sure that this was the movie they wanted and the characters they wanted. But you talk about Tony Stark and the character that was designed for Robert Downey Jr. Well, Robert Downey Jr. designed that character, basically. In fact, Jeff Bridges even said that he felt like making the movie was a quote, $200 million student film, unquote, because there was no script and no rehearsals. And Jeff Bridges is is insanely uncomfortable with that kind of mm-hmm. environment. He's a guy who prides himself on his work, on his craft, on coming in with knowing all of his lines and knowing his blocking and doing the job. And yet this was a movie that was unlike any that he had ever made. And he said that once he realized that it was like this $200 million student film, the pressure was off. And now he could have fun with this character of Obadiah. And so, when we think about how intricately designed all of these movies are now, mm-hmm. and then you go back to 2008, where this was an experiment, where they hoped and prayed that just the first phase would work. It's insane.
It is. It is almost, it's as if everything aligned mm-hmm. in the exact way that it needed to, mm-hmm. everything from that, you know, the first film itself. And then of course that tag at the end, which sets up several phases.
Yeah. Yeah.
All of that had to work mm-hmm. and look, you know, doing the rewatch, I recommend the rewatch. I know a lot of folks have done this during the pandemic, is to start from 2008 and move through the Marvel Cinematic Universe, especially because we have these shows coming out, Loki being the one that's currently on the air mm-hmm. that just started. And there is this sense of mental, psychological distancing, because I kept thinking to myself, this was the emergence of this huge movement for Marvel. And that made me think about where I was at the time and what I was going through and how I reacted and responded to the film and the excitement that I felt about that door being open.
Yeah.
And all of the things to come. I also feel like this was the beginning of this whole sort of entertainment media movement or concept of, we're grabbing you for a long time. Like, we want you with us through not just this one movie, but this franchise, this storytelling, this arc that's going to take us 10 years or more. Mm-hmm. That didn't, I can't recall something so intentional with my fandoms.
Yeah.
I guess Star Wars sort of sets that up, but it didn't set it up from the beginning. I mean, you go back and, I mean, just listen to the audiobook of The Secret History of Star Wars.
Yeah.
Like, none of that was supposed to right. pan out the way it did.
Right.
And I'm curious to hear from folks who are listening, was this for them a similar time in their life when they realized, I'm going to become attached to this storytelling. I'm going to form a relationship with these characters mm-hmm. and I'm like, I have the invitation received loud and clear. I'm on board. Let's do this. Mm-hmm. I can't think of another fandom or another story that has done this to me and
no,
for me.
No, no, it's perfect. I mean, there's some misses.
Well,
there's some misses. I'm talking about the entire franchise. Is so perfectly executed.
Yeah.
Now, there are some misses in there occasionally. You know, I'm not a huge Iron Man 2 fan. We'll talk about that when we talk about Iron Man 2. I'm not a big fan of the second Thor movie. We'll talk about that when we get there. But it doesn't matter, because that same year, there were usually one or two, maybe even three other movies that were coming out that were all part of the same universe. So it was like watching a TV series where it's like, yeah, I didn't really love this episode, but the tag at the end set up the next episode, and the next episode was amazing.
Yeah.
And so it's really hard to knock the franchise as a whole for, in any way. It was just, just brilliantly done.
Well, and when this movie came out, so as you know, I'd been a huge DC fan as a child.
Yeah.
And had already been very connected to Batman stories. In 2008, I was in grad school. And I'd say this was around the time, it was the year before my first Comic-Con. And this was the first year that I started to work with service members and veterans who were returning from OIF, OEF, Operation Iraqi Freedom, Operation Enduring Freedom, multiple conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Mm-hmm.
And I also started to write about and study and present on these relationships between combat soldiers and superheroes and make those connections to help people understand PTSD mm-hmm. and delayed onset of PTSD, the trauma responses to multiple combat-related adversities. So for me, this movie came out at a time that was, I'd say, like it was a turning point in my career. I started to kind of make those connections. It took several years for me to have more of that aha moment.
Yeah.
It wasn't until 2011 that I started to really, really dovetail, intersect and merge these fields. But that, I'd say that was the first milestone in my career about thinking, analyzing and considering these concepts together.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, this movie brings that back. It yeah. reminds me of that really, really important time.
Yeah.
Personally.
Let's talk about this movie. This movie starts out with the character that we've been describing, this pompous, self-concerned, brilliant inventor, the son of another brilliant inventor, who has a troubled party lifestyle. Now, you mentioned earlier that you sort of equate him to the Bruce Wayne. You think that some of it is put on. I'm pretty convinced that Tony is exactly as advertised. I don't think Tony is any different than he has let on. I think there are occasional moments, particularly with Pepper, who in this film is his executive assistant. I think that there are moments where he is very genuine and he sort of drops the shield a little bit, no mm-hmm. pun intended. But I think that he is still that guy. He is still super brilliant and super okay with letting you know it. And I don't think that that is a performance, because by the time he gets to this more, I don't want to call it philanthropic, but the moment that the change happens in him, mm-hmm. where he is...
He's more pro-social. He starts to use his purpose for good.
Yeah, he starts to, you know, and he's already got this life of... this lifestyle
yeah.
to make up for, you know, and he's actively trying to skid the car to a halt and turn it around. But I do think that most of what you see is exactly who Tony is. Do you disagree?
No, I think you're right. I think that Bruce Wayne is a method.
Mm-hmm.
I think he has to, employ that detached playboy
mm-hmm.
billionaire persona in order to, well, for one, as I mentioned in about 1,000 episodes before this one,
mm-hmm.
Because he's managing trauma in a certain very particular way, but also because of his superhero lifestyle that he kind of needs to rely on this, protecting his secret identity.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think you're right. I think Tony Stark is who he is, like who we meet, how he acts, who he is exactly authentic.
Mm-hmm.
And there is, as I mentioned, this fragility or this sense of, I don't know, a sense of loneliness, a sense yes. of, wound.
Yeah.
I you know, he's wounded, but he isn't trying to...
Literally heartbroken.
Yeah, but he's not trying to hide that, which again then makes it even more authentic.
Mm-hmm.
Like
mm-hmm.
we see somebody who is outwardly being pretty candid mm-hmm. about who he is. So you're right. I think that there is a difference there. He has some features of narcissism, and yet I wouldn't necessarily say that he has narcissistic personality disorder or a form of narcissism that is impairing.
Okay, so describe that. Describe the difference between what you just said, showing signs of narcissism, but not to the point that it is impairing. So what would be the difference?
So narcissistic personality disorder is a clinical disorder characterized as a pattern of very pervasive ongoing grandiosity and this real sense of superiority, the need for admiration, the need to be almost rewarded. Like the narcissism is so high that there needs to be constant affirmation and rewards. It's this deserving, entitlement. Okay. I need to be not only seen and admired for these qualities that are superior to others, but also I am going to live a lifestyle and receive the luxuries that are purely related to my superior qualities. So it's this sense of, it's exhausting. If you know somebody who has this disorder and you're in a relationship with them or you know them, it can be exhausting because how they relate to others is very painful. They do harm. They gaslight. And so they make their partners or their friends, if you want to call them friends, feel as though they're the ones who are weak, who are not doing the right thing, who are not fulfilling the relationship in the way they're expected to, because the person with narcissistic personality disorder has such high, impossible standards.
And in this particular case, Tony is someone who prefers to stay alone, who prefers to, in that Bruce Wayne sort of way,
right,
keep women on his arm, but never keep them around. Meanwhile, it's interesting that I was thinking back because when we were first introduced to Tony, not first introduced to Tony, but, within the context of the timeline, Tony is in a Vegas casino gambling while he is supposed to be receiving an achievement award from someone at the hotel at the, I think it's the Caesars. And there's an interesting dichotomy there because someone who is all about themselves would love this hype and praise. Mm-hmm. They would love being in a room that was there to cheer for them. And they would love to take that spotlight and hold the trophy. And he genuinely doesn't care. He would rather be in the casino holding court in a completely different way amongst the people, amongst the other degenerates who are all gambling away all their money. And he even loses a significant amount and brushes it off. Now, that's the difference between him and the other people at the casino. But yeah, it is an interesting dichotomy that you point out.
Yeah, folks with more intense and strong narcissistic traits will do more harm to others. They'll belittle others in order for them to feel bigger. They will play the victim, just try to come across as the one who should be getting the attention or the rewards or the fulfillment. They are incredibly critical and negative about other people, and they lack empathy. So they're really almost, I wouldn't say completely unable, but unwilling and have a difficult time seeing other people's perspectives, understanding the world through someone else's lens, which makes them callous. It could make them incredibly antisocial because of that level of callousness. And you don't really see that with Tony, but you do see some elements of, he has this mindset that because of his genius level intellect and because of his family background, because of his estate, because of his discoveries and scientific innovation. He wears that. Mm-hmm. He is completely owning those achievements, and he's unapologetic. Mm-hmm. Now, does he lack empathy? No, I think he is very empathetic. I think he does, if he wants to, he could see other people's perspectives. And frankly, I don't think he wants to be a bad guy. Like, I don't think he's interested in putting others down in order to feel better. Mm-hmm. So there are some, you know, there's a spectrum here. There's some elements that really make him difficult. Like, think about being Pepper Potts,
yeah,
who is his assistant. She's been somebody who's close to him in that dynamic for a long time. We're introduced to her where she's already had this relationship with him, mm-hmm, professionally, mm-hmm, and closely for many years. She sees these elements, she sees these features, and she knows that he is damaged in this way. She knows that he's hyper-focused. He is unable to pull himself away from his own experience.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it's very frustrating for her.
So talk about Pepper and talk about that relationship. You're talking about it being frustrating, and you're talking about people who are those who surround someone who might have the spotlight for a significant amount of time.
Right. She has to have a pretty strong ego in order to endure some of his unintended cold manners, right? Mm-hmm. Like, think about that scene where she greets the woman. I think she's a journalist. One of your favorite actors. I forgot her name already.
Leslie Bibb.
Leslie Bibb wakes up in Tony's bed, is amazed, like just mesmerized by being in his home and seeing the lavish surroundings, mm-hmm, the giant windows, and she's, you know, 100 stories high and is looking across the city. She is greeted by Pepper Potts. Tony's nowhere to be found.
Yeah.
And she's given her clothes that have been dry cleaned, and she's sent home. And the exchange is interesting.
I have that exchange. I can play it right here for you.
You are not authorized to access this area.
Jesus. That's Jarvis. He runs the house. I've got your clothes here. They've been dry cleaned and pressed, and there's a car waiting for you outside that will take you anywhere you'd like to go.
You must be the famous Pepper Potts.
Indeed I am.
After all these years, Tony still has you picking up the dry cleaning.
I do anything and everything that Mr. Sark requires, including occasionally taking out the trash. Will that be all?
So clearly it's not the first time that Pepper has sent a woman home.
Right.
And it's not, I see Pepper as someone who, again, ego strength is there, boundaries are there. And also I think that it seems like at this point her mind is set and clear, mm-hmm, about what this business is. And in that way, you don't feel sorry for Pepper. You feel like she's got her own. You feel like she can manage this situation. Mm-hmm. You don't yet know that there's feelings there. We learn about that a little bit later. But that's sort of our introduction to their relationship.
Yeah. Tony is also surrounded by other allies. I won't necessarily say friends yet, but you've got James Rhodes, also known as Rhodey. He's a colonel in the Air Force, and in the original comic, he was a Marine pilot, but we're going to ignore that. Played by Terrence Howard, adequately well. I'm not someone who's going to jump on him, but I gotta say I really like Don Cheadle. Later, mm-hmm, we're not allowed to talk about future roles, but the difference being here is that Terrence Howard's Rhodey seems to be consistently aggravated and openly aggravated, but seems to love his friend to some degree. And this is a character who takes a lot of punches over the course of this first Iron Man movie.
Mm-hmm. And I think there's a proxy for us here, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. He's the one who says, you know, why just behave? Why can't you stay within the lines? Why can't you just get through a press conference and not act out? Mm-hmm. I need you to be right. I need you to be in line. And looking back on this, I think there's some elements, like, let's be clear, there are not a lot of characters of color,
yeah,
in the Marvel Cinematic Universe,
yeah,
for some time. And now I'd say there's some improvement, but watching this now, it's an interesting dynamic because it's saying, you're this white rich man. You can get away with literally destroying the city and acting out and getting drunk and just being so outwardly,
yeah,
reckless and irresponsible. And here's this uniformed black man who's like, I can't do that. I have no, you know, ability to get outside of the standards and frankly, the stereotypes that I'm subjected to. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, could have been unintended. But for me watching that back, I felt like that is almost a proxy. Like I'm saying the same things. This is why I don't like Tony Stark sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, wow, you get away with a shit ton.
And
that's frustrating.
And Tony has convinced him. He has charmed him into drinking the sake. Rhodes starts out not wanting to fall into that trap, but of course, in that almost sitcom way of the screen tiling around and
yeah,
suddenly they're both hammered with the stewardesses,
and the stewardess are dancing and removing their clothes. There's a a stripper's pole.
But again, you've got a character who shows off his charm. Like, you can deny me all you want, but by the end of this conversation, you're going to be hammered on this plane, yeah, with me.
Yeah.
And you're still going to be talking about the importance of the uniform and the importance of your role in this world, but you are still going to be hammered with me on this plane.
So you're saying it's okay that we feel some sense of resentment toward Tony at
100%, this time? 100%.
Because I even felt uncomfortable with that scene. I just felt that was...
Yes.
Of course it's ostentatious, but it's also... sometimes it comes across as objectifying and demeaning toward the women that work for him.
Yeah. No, it's 1,000% objectifying, yeah, and demeaning. I mean, he's built an airplane with an attachable stripper pole in the middle of it.
Because
if you notice,
so
like, because that pole wasn't there earlier in the scene. Like, it was a respectable...
That doesn't come with most private planes.
Yeah, it was a respectable professional airplane. And then suddenly... And you get the sense that this is a man who hires the crew for his airplane to look a certain way. You know, they're going to look and act a certain way. And I don't think there's any question about what kind of person this is.
Mm-hmm. This is the setup.
This is what you see.
Yep.
And so then he goes and makes a presentation in Afghanistan for the Jericho missile, a missile that fires up into the air and then unleashes hundreds of tiny bombs and creates an impressive display in another country. The military is all happy. And then his convoy of Humvees are attacked by an unseen force, and those soldiers jump into action. Now, to this day, I cannot see this scene without thinking of you and the panels you used to give about combat veterans and police officers who are real life superheroes, because you used to have actual dash cam footage of a Humvee attack by an IED. And talk a little bit about that and how it relates to the people that we are seeing in this scene.
Yeah. So our training, and I'll be clear that in my work as a psychologist in training, I never was deployed anywhere.
No.
And some psychologists do serve in the military and are right alongside service members, and certainly do quite amazing work. In my work, I'm receiving the service members who return from deployment. Mm-hmm. And actually, in probably 100% of the cases, multiple deployments, which we'll talk about in a bit, because I think there's some relationship to Tony Stark's delayed onset of PTSD.
Okay.
We would study and really get more familiar with the experience of combat.
Okay.
In particular, conflicts that were modern. So at the time, you noted that in the early 60s, the comic books about Iron Man were framed and took place in Vietnam.
Yeah.
And so you have a similar...
Well, it was Vietnam. It was anti-communist. Yeah. And
yeah.
Yeah.
And so here it's set in Afghanistan, mm-hmm. in the late early 2000s.
Which is an ongoing thing with these books, like The Punisher, yeah. and with Iron Man. Iron Man has been updated many, many times over the years,
right.
to be the current mm-hmm. engagement we are in. But yeah.
Right. So in the particular training cohort that I was in, we were studying conflicts that were specifically happening in Iraq and Afghanistan. And we would watch videos that that demonstrated IEDs going mm-hmm. off, mm-hmm. improvised explosive devices. And we would better understand how an experience like that would impact a soldier psychologically. So I became more familiar with what that would look like almost in a vicarious way. When we talk to service members who are struggling, we also need to know the right questions to ask, like what kinds of experiences they may have endured.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes people aren't just going to list all the things that they remember, either because they actually can't remember it or they don't choose to. So you have to really be specific. Were you exposed to chemical weapons?
Yeah.
Were you exposed to, biological weapons? So very specific and gentle questioning to get a better understanding of what those visceral real life experiences were. It's not easy. It sure is easier than the person, than being in the seat of the person who had to endure all that. But we really tried to just get a sense of what those experiences could have been like.
Yeah.
And so as a presenter, I would show some clips. They were not violent. They would actually show an IED go off on a road or, in front of a Humvee. We didn't really show anything at Comic-Con that was graphic, of course.
Yeah, yeah. There was never anything graphic, but it was always mm-hmm. startling because you heard the responses mm-hmm. of the people inside
yes.
the Humvee.
And that was the exact point. What our audiences needed to learn and what psychologists understood is that the experience is unexpected, shocking, and really impactful on the senses. And so, of course, when you're seeing a soldier who doesn't want to be out the night of 4th of July,
mm-hmm.
or lives next to a train track or a place where planes come by, all sorts of reasons why that would be uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
It makes sense. You're hearing some of the same sounds. You're feeling some of the rumbling. You're getting these visceral physical triggers that then jog these memories. So when we rewatched Iron Man, the realism of that scene was, markedly important.
Yeah.
And I still think it holds up. It's a really shocking experience. He's doing what everyone does in within the culture of the military. You're mm-hmm. having normal conversations, kind of doing your business, you
joking
know,
around.
Yeah. Every, at some point your experiences become business as usual.
Yeah.
And they're interrupted by this grand explosion. And several people are murdered.
Yeah. And nearly Tony is, he manages to escape the Humvee, but is essentially blown up by his own weapon, a small bomb that lands next to him and explodes, shrapnel going everywhere. He goes unconscious and wakes up having a battery attached to his chest. And that battery is connected to an electromagnet that is preventing shrapnel from entering his heart and killing him. The point of this is so that he can then create the Jericho missile for Raza, the leader, we think, of this organization called the Ten Rings. More on that later. And with him is another professor, another engineer by the name of Ho Jensen. Now, this is a character from the comic. In the movie, he doesn't remember ever having met Jensen at a conference because he was super hammered. Mm-hmm. But in the comic, Tony actually knows who he is, and actually as a child, Prodigy looked up to him. So he's basically meeting a hero of his, which is removed from the movie. And I think that that is done, one, to simplify things. We don't want to know who this character is in Tony's quote-unquote past. But I think more importantly, it still centers the movie on this narcissistic character. Yeah, of course I don't remember you. Mm-hmm. I was hammered, you know. I appreciate that change. But the majority of the rest of the story of Jensen is the same. He helps Tony by creating this electromagnet. He then helps Tony, who is supposed to be building these weapons for this group. Now, in the comic, it was Wong Chu, and it was for the Vietnamese communist, the communist army. And in this case, it's this character who's in charge of the Ten Rings. He's a warlord, and he's there in Afghanistan. And Jensen ultimately helps him and then sacrifices himself so that Tony can escape. All of this happened in the comic as well. But this is the turning point for Tony. This is the moment that Tony realizes that his weapons are being used by the enemy to overtake villages and innocent people. Up to this point, he just believed that he was doing a job that is going to be done by someone else if I'm not the one doing it and profiting off of it. And we're putting them in the hands of the American army, who is doing the Lord's work out in this other world. Meanwhile, a gun is a gun is a gun. It can be used by anyone. Stark weapons can be used by the enemy against the very Americans he is trying to protect.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a yeah. real eye-opening moment for him.
Well, it's an eye-opening moment on the heels of multiple traumas.
I want you to talk about that for sure, especially as someone who's dealt with someone who've dealt with people who have had life-changing experiences. Talk about those multiple traumas and what that can do to a person.
Well, if we just think about what Tony's experienced in such a short period of time, I don't know how long it took for his operation to happen, for the first version of the arc reactor to be implanted mm-hmm. in his chest and to essentially be keeping him alive. But this is a matter of days, right?
Yeah.
So in a matter of just a few days, he's witnessed multiple people horrifically gunned down. He's felt a sense of complete loss of safety and vulnerability in that Humvee. And you're just that moment where all the soldiers have been killed and he's alone in that Humvee, crawls out, and then is encountering an explosive and it goes off.
Yeah.
So there's just right there a couple of really critical incidents that happened to him, life-threatening experiences. And the capturing of Tony and the injuries, the operation, and then the discovery that he has this battery attached to him.
Yeah.
So that he's more vulnerable. But I'd also say there's this realization that not only has he had these life-threatening experiences, he's facing a life-threatening situation. He's sure. not out of danger.
Yeah.
By way of being held captive, but also being connected to this battery in such a sort of crude way. It'd be different if he woke up in a hospital.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So multiple life-threatening events, and then realizing he's currently facing a hostage situation. And where he is, you know, I think he's lived his life in a very protected way. He's either been able to have his father maybe get him out of situations, or he's had his friends and his assistant, Pepper Potts, his own financial backing to ensure that he's really not ever in danger, mm-hmm. Personally. And he now is relying on this one gentle-mannered scientist, medical scientist to save him.
Yeah.
That's quite a lot to endure. And then he has this realization, this emotional discovery that is compounding the stress that I just described. Mm-hmm. This cognitive shift is the discovery that he's been contributing to some nefarious things. Things that he doesn't believe in. He, as you said, he's, you know, he might be pro-weapon, and he might be profiting from supplying the military with these guns and all of this equipment that's just mm-hmm. going to prolong war.
Yeah.
But he realizes that he's not, you know, that there's this moral distress related to this, and that distress is almost in it of itself another trauma. Mm-hmm. Wow, I'm that guy. Like, I've been significantly contributing to some horrific things that I didn't know about.
Yeah.
And that disillusionment, or that surprise, the shock from that discovery, is interacting with all of these other traumatic responses.
Right.
So one could say that is the formula that then motivates him to direct his purpose toward something good, toward something pro-social, to undoing the harms that he's contributed to.
Yeah. Okay. So then we have to talk about Obadiah Stane a little bit, the man who was business partners and a fellow engineer with Stark's father, who has basically been in charge of the company off and on. He took over until this Wunderkind shows up and reclaims the company. But ultimately, he's the big bad. He's the guy who wants to continue being the warmonger. He wants to continue making the weapons and profiting on them, regardless of who is using them. And he's even the person who set Stark up to be killed in Afghanistan. He wants the business for himself. Mm-hmm. And so, interestingly, before even Tony decides not to make weapons anymore, Obadiah can't be satisfied with his role as second fiddle. Obadiah, played by Jeff Bridges, very well, I might add, is really not that interesting a character in terms of...
I was just going to say, I just don't... You're right. Like, Jeff Bridges is great. I don't care for this. Yeah,
this
villain.
Is Iron Man's movie. It's the origin of Iron Man. It's not really, and I appreciate that they did this because they gave Iron Man, already a very fantastical character, a very human villain. Because, you know, when you think about where we end up taking this entire Marvel franchise, you need to ground it in some kind of reality, which was actually the problem they were having. This is one of the reasons the script wasn't finished when the movie started. When they were originally pitching this out to Comic-Con audiences back in the day, a couple of years before the movie even came out, the Mandarin, who has always been Tony Stark's main villain, was going to be the villain of this movie. But with the Mandarin comes magic. And that became a really hard thing to, you know, if they had made that movie, I think it would have been crap. And luckily they didn't make that movie. They saved, quote unquote, the Mandarin for a later Iron Man film. And then we'll talk more about that as we get there. And the Ten Rings. But they needed a villain. So Obadiah Stane became that guy and ultimately ended up creating a bigger, better version of the Mark I armor that Tony made to get out of that cave and became Ironmonger. Then it's just basically a big fight. It's a big punchy fest for the last 20 minutes of the movie.
Well, what I found, so the one thing that I found was interesting is that Obadiah drove the narrative that Tony was crazy.
Yeah.
You know, like he weaponized the psychology of this. He convinced the board that Tony was suffering from PTSD and is not capable. He doesn't have the mental capacity and he's too impaired to run the company. He's going to make decisions that are impulsive and not good for the long run success.
And by the way, he's not wrong.
Well,
you know, when you're thinking about the business side,
the
long run of Stark Industries, he might not be wrong. I mean, he's wrong about Tony being crazy and you know, all of that, but in terms of like just being a concerned member of the Stark board, he's not wrong.
It takes some additional steps to get there.
Yeah.
In that, From what I understood, Tony did not receive a clinical assessment and go through the proper evaluation, determine a diagnosis, be offered treatment, which, by the way, he would be getting state of the science, like the most most expanded and thorough treatment plan of anyone I could ever think of. Mm-hmm. None of those things happened, and it shouldn't. Like, that would have made this movie a whole different thing. I'm not saying it should be in the script. What we get, though, is that has to happen, this mechanism of Tony getting pulled further from the company, losing control of the company, and needing to take things into his own hands, vis-a-vis the Iron Man suit, in order to complete this redemption mm-hmm. that he needs to achieve. The PTSD thing is it's okay if it's inaccurate. Does that make sense?
Like, yeah.
It's this, it gets into the tabloids. It's a rumor. It is a mechanism. And the truth is, and so I like that because it's not the truth.
Yeah.
The truth is that yes, Tony is, before he went to Afghanistan, he was already suffering from, I'd say, many things. It's possible that he did have some alcohol use or substance use disorders or habits that were problematic. We don't get enough of that in this film to truly know or understand mm-hmm. the depth of that problem. Mm-hmm. It's likely that, again, as I mentioned, there's some narcissism there. There's some social detachment. There's a lack of meaningful personal relationships that make me wonder, is he okay? But we don't get a lot of the PTSD yet. We have what's required for PTSD in that we have multiple traumas that were shocking to him, and that all of that upheaval shocked his system,
yeah.
not just his physical system,
yeah.
but his emotional system. So one would expect that would have some impact on him psychologically. But the movie doesn't give us enough time for that.
Yeah.
And that's why I said it's likely he doesn't yet have PTSD, but we need things to unfold for us to even get to that diagnosis. And I'd say that he probably would have what's called a delayed onset of PTSD. After this calms down and he resumes his control of Stark Industries and he's sort of back in his normal lifestyle, what happens then? Is that the point in which he experiences the flashbacks and nightmares?
Okay, so I do want to save a little bit of that for the upcoming movies, because I actually...
We'll get there.
Yeah, I question something that you... I mean, I'm not questioning something that you're saying. I have a question regarding to Tony about something that you're saying, and I think that you're going to be able to address it well. We should say that he beats Obadiah and the Ironmonger suit, and then holds a press conference where he is specifically told by Agent Coulson of S.H.I.E.L.D. to stick to the script, that he was on a party boat with a bunch of other people, and that he was nowhere near the area of Stark Industries, that the Iron Man suit is a robotic bodyguard, which is what actually happened in the comic. I mean, for years, Iron Man was the robotic bodyguard to Tony Stark. And in fact, there's an entire story where Happy Hogan, who in the movie is played by director Jon Favreau, where Happy has to don the suit in order to allow Tony and Iron Man to still be in two different places. And so,
wow.
You know, it was very, very Superman becoming Batman for a period of time. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so I want to ask you about this. We were talking about the narcissist who then has a little bit of a change of heart and continues down the better path. When we get to this press conference, he is challenged, and I want to play this little bit of audio from you. And again, this is from Everhart, Christine Everhart, the reporter played by Leslie Bibb. And she challenges his notion that he may have even been Iron Man.
There's been speculation that I was involved in the events that occurred, the freeway and the rooftop.
I'm sorry, Mr. Stark, but do you honestly expect us to believe that that was a bodyguard in a suit that conveniently appeared, despite the fact that...
I know that it's confusing. It is one thing to question the official story and another thing entirely to make wild accusations or insinuate that I'm a superhero.
I never said you were a superhero.
Didn't?
Mm-mm.
Well, good, because that would be outlandish and fantastic. I'm just not the hero type, clearly, with this laundry list of character defects, all the mistakes I made, largely public. Yeah, okay, yeah. Truth is, I am Iron Man.
This was also a line, by the way, that was improvised, and Feige liked it and let it stay in the cut. And it actually informed the decision that there really weren't going to be any superheroes in the foreseeable future that were going to have alternate identities, that they were all going to be out in the open to the public in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Mm-hmm. And really, when you think about it to this day, the only person who really has a secret identity is Spider-Man. It's just Peter Parker.
Right.
Everyone else is out in the open. So it's interesting that even this happened. But let's talk about this moment, because for me, this is a really big deal. You've got a character who hasn't changed too much to be a completely different person, because when challenged with the notion that he couldn't possibly be this character, he can't stay quiet. He has to take the spotlight. Talk about that, Dre.
Well, it sounds like you think it's somewhat of an impulsive response.
I totally think it's an impulsive response. I think it's a reaction to the audience who kind of laugh. When he says, I'm not suggesting I'm Iron Man, and she's like, no one thinks you're Iron Man.
Yeah, like, how could it be you?
Yeah, and they all kind of laugh at him. It's in that moment that you see his eyes go, you know what?
It is. I guess... I'm not disagreeing with you. It is impulsive. But it is consistent with how he has been as a character.
Mm-hmm.
He, I think that he, you know, again, he's this brilliant guy. And I think he's constantly doing sort of this cost benefit analysis with each, you know, I don't see him as that impulsive.
Mm.
It is, maybe it is a calculated risk.
Mm, so that little delay is him making those micro calculations instantly.
Yes, like what do I have to lose? And I think frankly, with someone like Tony Stark, he is not interested in creating a lifestyle where he's hiding, where he has to protect a part of himself. That's not the work he wants to be in.
Yeah.
He doesn't want that kind of distraction. He really wants to hyper-focus on Iron Man being the weapon. And who cares if he's open about him being in that suit? So it's, and I think what's important too is that he doesn't, to say I am Iron Man isn't the same thing as saying I'm in the suit.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying there's no difference between Tony Stark and Iron Man.
Yeah.
We are one. We are the weapon. We are the hero. We unequivocally represent this new frontier of science and war, to be quite honest.
Yeah.
So is that response impulsive? I think maybe the that what he decided to say might have been impulsive. But I, my guess is that this has been just simmering in him for you know, the since the conflict with Obadiah, that he's essentially deciding, I'm committed to being Iron Man.
Yeah.
And in order for me to be straightforward and on and steadfast with this commitment, I just need to tell people. I don't want to worry about not telling people.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want that baggage.
Yeah.
And it is that, and I, what I do agree with you as well is that, that there's a narcissism about that too. He doesn't see anything wrong with also owning the destruction that he created as Iron Man, meaning I broke laws, I killed people, I destroyed buildings, I was a menace. I'm Iron Man. Like, yeah, so I did all those things. And again, it's that sense of, it's that maybe there's a sense of pride there, but it's also a lack of accountability almost. Like, I'm not, he doesn't really recognize that he's been pretty reckless about this venture.
Yeah. Let's talk about that accountability, because the next thing we see after the closing credits is that tag that you were referring to, where he enters the home. He doesn't know where Pepper is. It's dark. Jarvis doesn't seem to be operating properly. And then we are introduced for the first time to Samuel L. Jackson as Nick Fury, who questions Tony's need to out himself as the Iron Man. And he proposes that they sit down and talk about the Avengers Initiative.
This is the first invitation. We're going to get so many, but this is pivotal, right? It's the first invitation to join the Avengers Initiative, which is really nascent. There is no Avengers Initiative yet.
Yeah.
But Tony is one of the first to receive that call to action. Yeah. What do you think about Iron Man being in that, like being the first? Is it kind of what you talk about, where in order to get other folks on board, like high profile people on board to a project, you get that, like,
yeah, to get the A-list talent.
Yeah. Is that
who else is participating? You mean that, right. that question?
Does
that
he ask like, can I, who else has signed on? What am I getting into?
I don't know. It is interesting because Nick Fury does say you're not the only superhero, which implies that throughout history they have been aware of other superheroes. And of course we know now, but of course, you know, we're not allowed to talk about the fact that they certainly created Captain America, and they have created other characters since Captain America, oftentimes using the same serum. Again, we'll talk about all those characters as we get introduced to them. So for sure, there are other characters out there, but it's not like we have dealt with the Hulk yet. We've not dealt with Thor yet. We've not dealt with the other members of this Avengers team. So he's basically come to Tony saying, hey, I want to talk to you about the Avengers initiative, not knowing who else he's going to go to. Of course, he's Nick Fury. He's got information that we don't have. So we don't know what this means yet as audience members, but it does set up phase one where we are eventually going to hit the Avengers movie. By the way, this movie was so ragtag. This movie was so meta in a way. Forget the fact that much of the dialogue was improvised. In that closing scene right before the press conference, Tony is reading a newspaper that has a photo of Iron Man on it.
Mm-hmm.
And the newspaper is saying, like, who is the Iron Man? That photo is actually fan video footage from people who were spying on the set and shot video footage and released it. And they took a still from it and put it in the newspaper.
Oh.
So like, it's so of its time that like, oh, even while fans are watching us shoot, we're going to take elements of those things and we're going to put them in the movie.
Well, and that takes me back to what I was saying about our relationship with the MCU. That the very first movie was pulling us into this world, but also holding on to elements that were familiar to us. And the post 9/11 themes are so prominent and a very extreme, an overlay of war with the Middle East. The quote, bad guys being extremist terrorist groups, the articles in Wired and, you know, these high tech press conferences, the emergence of these big high profile men, white men who are running these huge corporations around technology. That was culturally all recognizable. But then you have things, of course, it's Marvel. You have things that are not recognizable. And they did that in a way that really captured our attention. And again, as I said, this is an invitation to be with us here. Yeah. And it works. It really works.
Yeah. And talking about the character of Tony Stark and Robert Downey Jr. specifically, he once gave an interview where he said, what I usually hate about these superhero movies is when suddenly the guy that you are digging turns into Dudley Do-Right, and then you're supposed to buy into all his let's go do some good, that Elliot Ness in a cape type thing. What was really important to me was not to have him change so much that he's unrecognizable. When someone used to be a schmuck and they're not anymore, hopefully they'll still have a sense of humor. So it was a conscious effort to make sure that Tony didn't change so drastically that he was unrecognizable from the moment we first met him.
Because why? You wouldn't trust him.
Yeah.
That's not something you trust.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that consistency is, and again, some people don't like how candid he is, but that is what keeps us recognizing him as a character throughout.
Right. And loving him. And we will continue to show some love as we continue our brand new excursion into the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Drea, until next time.
Wait, so that's one of many, like 25?
Yeah, many. There are many, many movies that we have to cover.
Well, that was fun.
And TV shows.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. I like doing a show about Marvel.
Yeah, it's fun. And if nothing else, we get to just sit down and watch the Marvel movies again, which we haven't done in a while. Drea, why don't you tell the folks online where they can, I'm sorry, why don't you go in and tell the folks at home where they can find you online?
They can find me on my website, drdreapsychology.com, or on social media at Arkham Asylum Doc.
You can find me on Twitter. I am at BWard028, on Instagram at B_Ward028. You can find us both on Twitter at Arkham Sessions and on Instagram at The Arkham Sessions. You can come follow us on Facebook. And as always, we want to thank our patrons for making this possible. Since our last episode, we've had a brand new patron join, and she gets to have her name called out in this episode. So thank you, Nicole Cochran, for joining Patreon. Hope you're enjoying everything, including these shout outs. We've also got all kinds of other things, like being able to watch video of Batman Beyond and get to hear our audio of Batman Beyond. You get exclusive voting power. You guys decided that we were going to work on the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and now we are doing it. Till next time, I'm Brian Ward.
I'm Dr. Drea Litamendi.
And together we are
The Arkham Sessions.
Vacation's over.